हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हाँ स्टूडेंट्स, लेट्स स्टार्ट हियर इन द फर्स्ट क्लास। Just excuse us, students. 2 minutes. We'll just resume the session. Good evening. Good evening, Nagendra, Sai, Ankur. I've already have told you the WhatsApp number. Please put across the query in the WhatsApp. I'll answer in that. So in just a minute, we'll start the session. Just I have to just put across the link. Yes, Ankur, in that number do put across your query. I'll definitely will do the needful. So good evening to all of you students. Good evening, students. So welcome to this particular, the first live session, which is there for the direct tax paper number 7. For all the students who will be having their attempt in May 21 and November 21 CA final attempt. Students, this is a first particular feature wherein we are going live. The batch should be conducted in a live mode. At the same time, those who are interested and willing to go for the G Drive batch, even for them, post 10th of July, the G Drive batch would be made available. So the G Drive batches, students, which would be there, would be made available from the 10th of July, after 10th of July. But so far as the live batch is concerned, students, starting from today, 23rd of June, we have 4 days a week. Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday in the evening, and on Sunday it will be at 10:30 in the morning. So this is a 4-day slot which we will be having for every week. Certain quick points which I'll just speak about it immediately. The first and the foremost thing, students, would be in the minds of the students about the for the live batch, what is the internet that will be required. So the internet requirement, students, would be the normal internet right now. That is the reason why we are looking at, like, you are doing the lecture in the YouTube, the normal internet that you are taking for a YouTube class, the same particular internet would be required. Other details, students, what is required for the other details, I have already have given those details to you, which was there in our DSTC app, or else there is a WhatsApp number in the description of this YouTube lecture. You can go through and get those particular other details, but it is very seamless. Students don't have to literally worry about this. Primarily, the way we discuss and interact in a live YouTube lecture, the similar would be the experience that you will have in our software as well. In fact, much better than what the YouTube will provide. For the G-Drive batch students, as I told you just now also, after 10th of July, this particular batch would be made available. So we will be putting across for our G-Drive batch after 10th of July. Now students, herein, good evening Krish, Kamalnath, Sai, Nagendra Babu. Let's get started with this one. So students, herein, in this context, the attempt that we all are now targeting here in this context would be good evening, Rajiv. Now, friends, as far as this, our major focus would be for the new course students, those who would be having their examination for the new course. For all of them, we will be focusing majorly for the new course. But some students will say, sir, we are giving in the old course. So, as far as the old course is concerned, students, primarily, as such, we have already told that for the new course, there are some additional topics. Old course, some few topics are not there. Fine. So, therefore, in this regard, it is essentially our lecture would only be for new course. Those extra topic which are there, which is actually meant only for the old course students, those topic can be skipped by the old of those extra topic which are there, which are meant only for the new course students. These topics would be skipped by whom? By the old course students. This is a limited aspect which I just wanted to communicate with all of you. Book students, total in all, there would be five modules. All the modules would be colorful modules, which should there. So modules are would be a colorful module in this regard, all amended amended as per the Finance Act 2020. All amended as per the FA 2020. In fact, from the next particular session, I'll be putting across the PDF also for this particular the amendment which has been there. The first four class students that we are going to do would be in the YouTube lecture. The mode would be in the YouTube lecture. So that would be our first particular four sessions which I'll be putting across in the YouTube, and thereafter the system software which are there, the system software can be taken into account. So it's like the first four lectures are more like a demo session. So you can opt for this particular four session, and thereafter the fifth class we are going to freeze it through our particular software itself. So those would be encrypted lectures that will be given. Now students, in this five modules primarily, now I'll just tell you the entire scheme of the things. We are going to cover comprehensively your entire syllables. Entire syllables would be covered direct tax paper comprehensively. In fact, this time we have included 150 problems more as compared to our previous edition, which was for May 20 and November 20 attempt. So technically speaking, roughly around, I am not yet counted it, but roughly around some 600 to 650 problems would be there in your module. And that eventually will cover students every permutation and combinations that you require to know, primarily as far as your CA final attempt is concerned. Means from the base level, I will be taking you through the most advanced level of interpretation, the cross interlinking between one provision and another provision. All these would be the features or the hallmark of our particular session on the direct tax law. One particular thought students that may have is that, sir, what about the factor that there would be the queries and all that can be asked? So, live students, anyway, you will be asking me throughout the lecture. But definitely, when I say throughout the lecture, at one particular point of time, I'll start putting I'll open up for the queries. At that point of time, you can ask me the queries, whichever are there. And for the G-Drive students, we are anyways going to create your WhatsApp group in which you will be putting across your queries itself. Yes, Mohammed Jasim has asked that, sir, will you be covering 600 practical problems in the class itself? Obviously, we will be. See, there would be some of the questions that will be from the practice point of view. Okay, so it's more like one particular practical problem. After that, there may be some couple of similar questions that will be there. So you yourself will come to know that we will be covering all the variety, and to foster your more practice, primarily we will be giving, I will be also having even questioning of those problems, so that any self student, any students who want to do a self practice of the same can definitely can get into that particular mode itself. Now, students, one particular part, students, which I just wanted to say to all of you is this. Apart from this five module, some students will say that is anything else that has to be covered? And the answer is no. In fact, of this entire five module, students, this time, primarily I also have started the revision sessions. And in fact, I have done a very exhaustive revision session as well with the students. The revision session, students, is based upon the way I'm going to teach you in the regular batch. So the style of my regular batch, same intensity and same level of interpretation, same level of flow, interlinking would also be a part of your revision class. Now, students, how the revision class would be there for every five module? What we are going to do is that approximately around 20 hours or 25 hours of revision session we are going to provide you separately. For that, primarily I will give you some, like, for the a summarized PDF, which can be either an ePDF, or this time I will also do a print of that PDF. So those who want a print version can also avail that particular PDF itself. So that way, what will happen is that after the completion of five modules, there would be a immediate revision lecture, which would be somewhere from January onwards. I'll start putting the revision lectures as well for those students who will have their attempt in May 21, which should be in a position to take the benefit. November 21 students, definitely you can all take the benefit at the same point of time. So please understand that this particular revision session will foster your last minute kind of the major concern of the students is that to revise it. So take it from me, the revision would be equally very penetrating the way you have learned the subject throughout in this particular five modules. So there is no such thing that is to be worried. So what is required from your end now? So all the students who are watching the lecture now, regular batch, May 21, November 21, from your end, primarily I require three color pen, blue, black, and red, or maybe a green, whatever it be. Three color pen, one highlighter, and one is the sticky notes, that yellow color and that pink color, that sticky notes that you have. Please have those particular five things with all of you. Why is it so? Because these things, students, direct tax paper, the way I'm going to take you through it, you yourself will realize that you will have to write a lot. I'll make you write a lot as far as the paper is concerned. You'll end up writing, writing and writing, because it's more important. It's not about only about understanding the provision. Understanding the provision is only one thing, students. It's more important how you express that particular provision in a given situation. I can tell you, while we will going it forward, understanding the provision is one thing, but the same provision when you have to put across, it is really very difficult. The challenge of the students in the direct tax paper is that why they don't score good marks is because they cannot express themselves well in this particular paper. And the biggest fallacy lies in the fact that they don't write, they only read. And this is exactly where, students, we will be putting our major effort. I'll make you write a lot. You will have to therefore be prepared that you will have to parallelly have to keep writing across the way I'm going to guide you through to the entire five modules that will be given to you. Module dispatch, students, the first four class, as I've already told you, no book as such would be required. From after fourth lecture, thereafter also one or two lectures, there will not be any requirement, but we will be starting a dispatch of our materials from this weekend. All the materials will be dispatched to all the registered students. From this weekend, we'll start dispatching the materials. But still, we will be giving for our first topic, primarily I will be giving you the PDF, so that if for any reason the books are in transit, at least there should not be any loss of session, and the PDF would be provided to all the students. First left topic PDF, I'll be providing it to you so that parallelly your lectures are going in a smooth manner. One major point that students have asked me earlier also in WhatsApp, which I just wanted to share with all of you, is this, that they are asking me that, sir, what about the fact that if supposedly we miss out on any of the lecture? There is a very valid reason you may miss out on some of the lectures. So students, we have the backup facility as well, and that is the beauty of the entire scheduling that we have done. You have one day gap in between, So supposedly in any way or in any case you have missed out on a particular session, you just have to intimate to our backend team. So that backend team accordingly will make you that particular lecture available. As you all know, your lecture schedule is Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday and Sunday. So already there is a gap in between, by virtue of which you will be in a position to see the lecture in that off day, and thereafter in the next class you will be all ready for your next session. Total number of class students would be, total number of session would be 69 classes. There are total number of 69 classes would be there. So total 69 lectures would be there, plus and minus here and there can happen, that but that cannot, based on my this thing, that cannot go beyond 6 to 7 class. But just, I'm just giving you the variance. There can be a 6-7 class. Obviously, there will not be minus. There would be only plus. If at all there would be a plus, it will be 7 lectures forward. So just I'm telling you at the very outset, so that expectation should be set across it. Because what happens is that we have to, because of the practice and other things, we have to ensure that we do a full justice as far as the course is concerned. Students, a lecture duration which we will have would be for 2 hours, 30 minutes to 3 hours. Now this depends upon, this all depends upon how we are going to take across on a particular day, which session is going on. On that basis, this 2.5 hours to 3 hours session will be allotted. Now only one particular point which I just thought of asking to all of you is this, that many students have asked me that to shift the live batch timing from 6:15 to 6:30. Basically their reason, actually they said 6:45, but I am thinking of proposing it to 6:30, for the reason being because of the articleship issues. So if 6:30 timing, students, if you are all finally fine, then we can propose 6:30 as the timing which has been there. So that is one thing which I will just give it to you, students, in this regard. 6:30 is the timing in this context. Now some queries are there herein. Amendments, Mohammed, this amendments are already factored in. This amendments which are there is already factored in our entire 5 modules. So you don't have to worry about the amendments part. It is already captured in our modules itself. But nevertheless, if there are something extra, if there are something extra which has been there, for that I will be putting across the lectures in the YouTube, because obviously the November students who are there, they look for the amendment for the May 21 attempt. So for that particular students, definitely we will look into that. Thank you, Anand. Thank you, Vikas. Yes, yes. Shreyans has asked, here in optional subject, international taxation will go parallelly. Right now, you don't have to worry about this one. You just focus on this paper number 7. The level of the international taxation and transfer pricing, although our optional paper 6 is also available, but the depth in which we will take across to paper to our paper number 7 for non-resident taxation and transfer pricing, you have to take a call whether you have to do it or not. Even 6C, any tuitions, you can do even a self-study. Even though I have got that 6C module also, 6C lectures are also there, but I told you that you decide only after you have gone through our paper number 7 lecture whether you indeed want to opt for any coaching for paper 6C. Okay, so that is one thing, the depth in which we cover the international taxation and transfer pricing. So don't worry about the same. Now students, accordingly, yes, Mohammed, 100 ICM materials and all the topics will get covered, and our practical question, and you will find our level of questions will be very high. You yourself will come to know, primarily, it's not that I'm boasting it across it, but our level of questions are really very high. And that exactly what you will in fact get through once you start doing this particular question set itself. Yes, yes, Sai, we will definitely will deal with the same. Okay, Yogesh, definitely I'll try to consider your request. Let's then start, students, then the first session. Let's get started with this. So accordingly here, students, first of all, in fact, when I was taking the, this would be a, again, I'm telling, this would be a purely a 100% English class. Okay, 100% English class is what I'm going to take right now. For Hindi, we have got a separate batch. Okay, but this would be a 100% English batch. Now, students, in this context, First of all, now, primarily, I'll again repeat, I will do it as if that you don't have any good understanding of DT in your IPCC. There is a reason for that, and you will also admit it that many of the students have focused on their IDT rather than DT in their IPCC level. And the reasons are known to all of us. And the reasons is that IDT, everyone has focused for the simple reason that by focusing on IDT, there was syllabus was very less, and thereby they have done a very thorough reading, scored a very good marks also in the tax paper. In fact, many students have ended up scoring even 60 plus. But the base is really very weak. And that is the reason why, this is through an experience which I come to know, the students' base is a bit weak as far as the direct tax paper is concerned. So I will be going through from the scratch. On that note, we are going to take it to the most advanced level of interpretation. So that is precisely how we are going to take it forward. Now, one more point, students. In fact, just I can just let you know. Students, in fact, this COVID situation which has been there, we have ensured that for a limited time we are keeping our, like, the fees are being kept because of the request of many. We are keeping our fees at a very reasonable price without compromising on any of the quality, either of the study materials or of the lectures also. We will be keeping the fees because in COVID situation, obviously many students have finding it difficult to meet their ends. So the fees you'll find also for a limited period of time, we will be keeping the fees on a very reasonable thing. In fact, the details of which you can find it in the DSTC app or even in that contact number which will be given in the description box. And that way, in fact, we are ensuring that the kind of a social responsibility which we can cater through a limited period at least. You see, I will be very frank with all of you. At least limited period, we are giving that window. Once primarily that window is done with it, so obviously we have also an institution to run and cater to. So only for that limited period, we are ensuring that maximum students get the advantage. That is what primarily the cause is all about. Let's then start with this particular thought through. And the first particular point is about you are right now going to learn Income Tax Act. Income Tax Act is a part and parcel of the direct tax law. Income Tax Act is what? A part and parcel of the direct tax law. Now, students, my question therefore to all of you is, what is then the difference between a direct tax and an indirect tax law? There has to be some difference between the two, isn't it? So what is the difference between the direct tax and the indirect tax law, students? Pavan Kumar, definitely I will do that. This week you will find the updations of the MTPs also. Don't worry. Last week there was a COVID situation in our office itself. Very tough time that last 10 or 15 days has happened because of the COVID issue. Obviously, nothing has happened to me, primarily, but in our office itself. Now, students, let me know in this regard quickly, difference between the direct tax and the indirect tax law. What is the difference between the two? Quickly, students, think about it. Those who are also in the G Drive listening to this particular lecture, they will also try to get to their answer. It's not that, okay, you will go in the sleeping mode just because you are not live. That does not mean that. Get your answer, and thereafter, once I put my answer, try to match up with your answer as well. So again, I'm repeating, students. What is the fundamental difference between the direct tax law and the indirect tax law? Say, students, quickly. Krish, Kamalnath, Muhammad, Yes. So more or less, I'd suppose that this is the answer which everyone will have it. In the context of this one now, friends, just pay attention herein. The fundamental aspect, direct and indirect tax. Indirect tax, friends, is also known as, I think you are aware of this phrase, destination-based consumption tax. All of you are aware of this particular phrase, isn't it? Destination-based consumption tax. So it is a consumption-based tax. And therefore, the incidence of the tax is on whom? The charge of tax is on the consumer, the one who consumes the goods or consumes the service. So, primarily, the one who is consuming it, the incidence or the levy or the charge is on that particular person who is known as what? Consumer. Either the consumer of the goods or the consumer of the services. However, even though the levy or the charge of the indirect tax is on the consumer, but the liability to pay or the collection of those taxes is made from the other person. The collection of the taxes is made from whom? From the other person. And that is the reason why, students, that is the reason why this particular tax is known as an indirect tax. So through the supplier, the tax is collected, which is ultimately borne by whom? By the consumer. Through the supplier, the tax is collected by the government, which is ultimately borne by whom? By the consumer. This therefore becomes a indirect taxes. And as far as a direct tax is concerned, as we all know, like income tax, isn't it? So the one who is earning the income, the incidence or the levy or the charge is on me as a person. Fine. And it is on me from whom the collection will be done by the government. So the liability to pay and the incidence of tax is on the same person. Repeat with me, students. The liability to pay and the incidence of tax is on the same person. Therefore, the tax is known as the direct taxes. Therefore, the tax is known as what? As the direct taxes. That exactly what you say and distinguish between the two. And what is that two particular term? The direct tax and the indirect taxes. Did you got this one, students? Fine. Fair enough. So this is precisely how it goes with it. Now, in this context, students, one point. Yes. Other particular point that you can always say, progressive, it is income tax is progressive, whereas indirect tax is static, isn't it? It's a fixed. Whereas in the context of the direct tax, it is progressive when you talk about the income tax. Because higher the income, higher the tax. That exactly what we know. Fair enough. That exactly how it is to be considered. Now, students, the syllabus that you all are doing is the Income Tax Act 1961. Is what? The Income Tax Act 1961. This is what? This is a element of direct tax. Sometimes, and in fact, at the very outset, let me take out this notion. Many students, even after the completion of their entire syllabus, they think that income tax and direct tax is one and the same. No, it's not one and the same. Income tax is an element of direct tax. Direct tax has got more than one element. Income tax is a direct tax. Why it is a direct tax? Because you find the same feature. What is that feature? Feature is the one who is on whom there is a charge or on whom there is a levy. From that person itself, the tax is collected. From that person itself, the tax is collected. Therefore, it becomes a direct tax. But apart from income tax, there are other taxes also, which is also the element of direct tax. Namely, I can say, for example, in this context, students, you will find the wealth tax. So if you talk about the wealth tax as well, you will find the same thing. And what is that in the context of wealth tax? In the context of wealth tax, it is the same particular point that you're going to get it, and that the wealth, the person who owns the wealth, so the levy is on the person who owns the wealth, and the liability to pay the wealth tax is also on the same person. Although I must say, wealth tax is not a part of your any syllables. In fact, Wealth Tax Act 1957 has been repealed. But be mindful and don't be surprised that in the next particular budget, because of this COVID situation or so, the government find a desperate need to collect more taxes and they start taxing the super rich who has got a huge amount of wealth. So therefore, you may find an introduction of a new tax tomorrow in the form of the Wealth Tax Act 1957. My gut feeling is that it would be there. It could be there. The Wealth Tax Act 1957, that will come in 2021. Not a part as far as your attempt is concerned. May 21 and November 21, don't worry. You will not have that as a part of your syllabus. But I am telling you that if supposedly a wealth tax also is introduced next year, so whether it will be a part of direct tax, how do you identify whether it is a part or an element of direct tax? So to identify that, what do you need to see? The levy, the charge is on the person. Is that same person is also having the liability to pay? If the same person has also the liability to pay, or the government collects the tax from the same person, then in that case, it also satisfies the criteria of being referred as a direct tax, being referred as an element of direct tax. So this is how, students, you should try to understand. When you read a law, this is precisely how you should try to understand. Am I reading a direct tax law or an indirect tax law? So that is fundamental structuring or categorization that each one of you should always be in a position to do it carefully. With that point, students, now the point, the syllables that you all have would be the Income Tax Act 1961. Now, one only point, students, before we can proceed. One only point, students, which I want to just share with all of you. Just pay attention to this. Students, this act which is there, the word act, primarily this particular word act, when you write your answer, whether this word act which is there as your first word or somewhere in between or towards the end, you will ensure what? That this letter A would always be in capital letters. Because I have just written the Income Tax Act 1961 in front of you. Just one important observation, students. If you write act like this, primarily, and 1961, irrespective of whatever beautiful answer that you may have written, however best the presentation you may have done, just write act like this, it would be a severe put off to the examiner. I'm not talking only about a direct tax. In IDT law also, act always, students, the letter A has to be always capital because it's a noun form. It's a noun form, students, and therefore it has to be always a capital letter. Just, I am telling you as a particular, one particular point, never, ever, ever, ever use a small letter when you have to write an act. Okay. Now, let's get started. So, I would try today, like in my next 3 to 4 lecture, my sole focus and the aim would be to develop the foundation, to develop a structural thought, how you are supposed to think so far as the subject is concerned. So let me in fact first develop your mind process, a mind mapping we will do so far as this subject is concerned, and then we will enter into the rules of the game, the nitty gritties, each and every part of the provisions. Now, students, whether you are doing a taxation law, be it direct tax or indirect tax law, when you are doing a taxation law, the very first section that you are supposed to refer, apart from the definition is section number 2, isn't it? Apart from the definition, the very first section, the very first section that you will have to refer, students, will be primarily, is which section? Which is a section that you will refer? The first section in a taxation law. Ranjit, I will answer your particular query a bit later. Okay? Towards the end, I'll answer you and I'll let you know. First, all of you, answer me this. Mike has given the answer. Mike, by the way, what's your name? So herein, in this context, the first section that you are supposed to look into it, Vijay, perfect. It has to be the charging section. The charging section. Now, what is this charging section, students? This charging section is nothing but provides you. Mohammed, perfect. It is the charging section. And this charging section provides you what? The taxable event. Sunir, perfect. That is the charging section. What do you mean by the term charging section? It means nothing but the taxable event. Taxable event, students, means an event. Please pay attention. Taxable event means what? An event on happening of which, an event on happening of which the tax becomes payable. Like, for example, just a very simple example is a customs duty. So there has to be a charging section which defines the taxable event, and the taxable event in the customs law happens to be the import of goods into or the export of goods from India. That happens to be the taxable event on the basis of which the duty of customs is charged. Same is also with the case with the GST. The charging section which lays down the taxable event on the basis of which the liability crystallizes, and the taxable event for the GST is the supply of goods and services. The supply of what? The goods and services. That happens to be the taxable event. Similarly, as far as the income tax law is concerned, what is the taxable event on the happening of which the income tax liability will become due? What is a taxable event, students? Let me ask you this question. Get started with this, all of you. Quickly. So for, as far as the income tax law is concerned, as far as the income tax law is concerned, students, the taxable event happens to be what? So students are suggesting in this regard, it is the income. Let me then, in that regard, students, put across section number 4 for all of you. Section number 4. So many students definitely would have the opinion now in this case is that the taxable event as far as the income tax law is concerned is the income. Is it an income? Let's have a look. Section 4 is the charging section. Now, in this regard, I'll just precisely right now will use a simple sentence. For the purpose of this chargeability, simple sentence, primarily herein I will just put across with for all of you. And if possible, Sunir has given the answer. If possible, students, if possible, you will also take a note. Parallelly, please take the note of the same, all of you. So here, section 4 says what? The total income of a person for a previous year is charged to tax in the next following AY. So here, students, what you are suggesting or you were suggesting was is that the chargeability is on the income. No, it's not on the income. It is on the total income. The chargeability, students, again, I'm repeating this point. The chargeability under the act or the taxable event is not an income, it is the total income. Now, definitely, when you are talking about a total, so please understand, there is a difference between the two. When you talk about the total income, so it means that you need to do a totaling of the income. Total income, if we just split this particular word, total income. So, total income. So, we require to do a totaling of the income. And whenever you have to do a totaling, students, you may be appreciating this point that the totaling has to be done for a particular period. The totaling has to be done for a particular period. And therefore, this period can be anything. It can be like a month, a quarter, a 6 months, or a 1 year. So here, the totaling has to be done for a particular period, which is known as what? As the previous year. Which is known as the previous year. And previous year, as defined primarily, which is also, there is a definition of previous year, which we will see later on. Section number 3, not right now. So the previous year, right now, simply put, it is a financial year. What is the previous year? It is nothing but a financial year. So therefore, here we need to do the totaling of the income for a particular period, and that period happens to be what? Happens to be a financial year. So this is precisely the point. So please understand one thing. If you say that the chargeability or the taxable event is on the income, then please understand one thing. Income is something which I keep earning every day on every transaction. And therefore, if you would have said that the chargeability is on the income, then you would have made the charge as a transaction based. Because as I told you just now, income you all earn for each and every transaction. And because you earn the income for each and every transaction, therefore it becomes what? A transaction based tax. But is it a transaction based tax? Income tax is not a transaction based tax. It's a period based tax. Income tax is not a transaction based tax. It is a period based tax. And how do I know that? Because the word is the total income. So therefore, it is a sum total of the income for a particular period. And therefore, it becomes, again I repeat, it's a periodic tax primarily and not a transaction based tax. GST if you see, or the customs law, students, if you see in this context, GST if you see, or customs law if you are seeing, then in the GST as well as in the customs law, you will find what? It is a transaction based tax. Why? Because please go, whenever you learn, I think that many of you would not have even touched right now IDT, but students, whenever you will get the opportunity to refer the charging section in the GST law, in the customs law, there please go through that, and there you will find they are not referring any previous year. So the charge is on what? On the transaction. Which transaction? Of the import or export, as far as the customs is concerned. On the supply of goods or services, as far as GST is concerned. So there is no period aspect. It is on that transaction or on that event, on that the charge has been created. So IDT is transaction based or event based, whereas DT is period based. And how do we know that? That this is known through the term total income. This is known through the term total income. Did you all got this one? This is precisely what, students, is the fundamental difference. So never says that the chargeability is on the income. The chargeability is on the total income. Now, the next question, students. Herein, the next question which has been there. Now, Muhammad and Arun, through the WhatsApp primary. Now, herein. Mohammed, that particular herein. What's up, Arjun? You will find it in our descriptive particular this thing. Again, I'm repeating, in the descriptive particular part, you will find the details of the WhatsApp number and all. So that is one thing which will be there. Fine, students. Now, coming on this particular part. Now, one thing which would be there, all the G Drive students, if any confusion is there, that sir, the live batch students will be asking the queries and we will not know about the queries. No, if I have to answer the queries, I will definitely will be putting across that question again in this regard, and definitely we will try to put across, will engage on the issues which are being raised by some of the students. Obviously some students' queries are really very good, so obviously I will try to ensure that all the students benefit from that particular query, so that definitely will be taken care of, don't worry the G Drive students. Now students, apart from this herein, just all of you will pay attention in this regard, in this context, my next particular question which has been there, is this. Pay attention to this one. What is the earliest point of time? What is the earliest point of time when you are capable of doing the totaling of the income? What is the earliest point of time when you all would be able or capable of doing the totaling of the income? For example, now the previous year students, which all of you are having, which previous year you all belong to? For you all, the previous year is 2021 and the assessment year is 21-22, isn't it? So we all are aware this previous year is 2021 and AY is 21-22. So the question to be asked to all of you is, for previous year 2021, you have to compute the total income. My question is, what is the earliest, point of time when you all will be able or capable of doing the totaling of the income for previous year 2021? What is the earliest point of time when you will be able or capable of doing the totaling for previous year 2021? Kamal, Arjun, that will be provided to you in the group. I will be there in all the groups, don't worry. I would be there in these groups. Deepu, Krish, Kamalnath, earliest point of time. Some students may have the thought, sir, it is 31st of March 2021. For previous year 2021, it is 31st of March. If you are saying, students, 31st of March, in this context, the answer is no. Why? Because even on 31st of March, you will be earning the income. Don't you agree to that? So definitely the earliest point of time for the purpose of doing the computation of the total income is not 31st of March, but it is the 1st April of the relevant assessment year. 1st April of what? Of the relevant assessment year. This is the earliest point of time where you are capable or able to compute the total income for the relevant previous year. So that is what primarily you would be in a position to do that. So here some students will say, like Johnny is asking here in, sir, the advanced tax calculation, there you don't calculate total income, there you are calculating the estimated total income. That's an estimated total income. Here it's primarily the part which we are asking right now is about the total income, which is subject matter of our charge. So the total income that you have to compute for the relevant previous year, the earliest point of time when you are capable to compute this total income happens to be the 1st of the April of the relevant AY. The 1st of the April of the relevant AY. And therefore, students, the 1st April of the relevant AY, in this context. And what is the relevant AY for all of you? It is AY 2021-22. So if that is the case, the 1st April 21, on this date, this is the date, students, is the most critical date. This is the date, 1st April of the relevant AY, is your relevant date. So be mindful of this fact, students. In IPCC, when you would have done GST also, there is a concept of point of taxation. You would have heard this, or time of supply, even that would have been heard by you, or relevant date in customs law. So what exactly is the significance? Because whatever relevant date, students, means this, the significance of relevant date in a taxation law is that on this date, whatever is the law which is enforceable, on this date, whatever is the law which is enforceable, based on that law, you will be computing the tax liability. Again, repeat with me. The concept of relevant date, or the significance or the importance of the relevant date, is that on this date, whatever is the law which is enforceable or which is applicable on that date, based on that, the tax liability will be computed. The tax liability would be computed. This is what you do in the IDT law also, for which you refer the topic. Which topic? Point of taxation, time of supply. Like, that is a topic that you are learning in the IDT. In DT, you don't have to learn all this point of taxation. Directly, it is the 1st April of the relevant assessment year. It is what? 1st April of the relevant assessment year. As on this date, you, whatever is the law which is enforceable as on this date, on the basis of that law, you will compute your tax liability. And that is the reason why, students, herein, on this date, the law applicable, the law enforceable on this date comma, based on which the tax liability shall be computed. The tax liability shall be computed. This is the significance, students, of what? Of the relevant date. Now, accordingly, as I told you, herein, in this context, therefore, the context, the point is about the tax liability. Now, tax liability, students, whenever you always understand one thing, any tax, DT or IDT, whenever you talk about the tax liability, it is always the function of two factors. Whether it is what? DT or IDT, the tax is always the function of two factors. And what is the two factors? One is the rate, and another is what? Another is the value. Another is the value. Like, even in the context of the IDT law, what is that you need to know? One is the rate of tax, another is the value. In the context of the customs law that you will learn, or you would have learned, you will know that it is about the rate of duty and the assessable value of the imported goods or the exported goods. So value, on that apply the relevant rate. Same is also the game with the IDT law, GST law. You have to know the value of supply, and on the value of supply you will apply the corresponding rate of CGST and SGST. That is what you all do, isn't it? Or IGST, as the case may be. So therefore, it is always a function of two factors, and therefore this tax liability, which is to be, as I told you, determined on the basis of the law as on the relevant date, which we all know 1st April 2021 is the relevant date for AY 21-22, 1st April 2021 for AY 21-22. So tax liability, function of two factors. And which are those two factors? Total income, and on that total income, multiply the total income with the rate of tax. Total income and the rate of tax. Now, students, this total income is also known as what? This is also known as the tax base. This is also known as what? The tax base. Now, how this term tax base has been determined? Please pay attention to this one. The term tax base, students, has been determined. This is what it is. As I told you, the tax is a function of two factors. One is the rate. So this is all about the rate, and this is your base. This is your base, students. Be careful. This is your base. And accordingly, this base, as I told you, it is the total income. primarily, which is known as the tax base. In IDT, this will not be total income. In IDT, it would be value. The value of supply or the accessible value of the imported goods, on that is your tax base. That is your tax base. On that tax base, you will apply the corresponding rate. On that tax base, you will apply what? The corresponding rate of tax. This is exactly how you will freeze your tax liability. Based on what, students? Based on the law which is applicable. Based on the law which is applicable as on the relevant date, which happens to be the first day or the 1st of the April of the relevant AY. 1st of the April of the relevant AY. That's the reason why, students, please pay attention to this particular point as well. You will find what? That many amendments which has taken place in the Finance Act 2020, many amendments will say what? This amendment is with effect from. This amendment is with effect from. You will find many amendments. I will also show you that. Whenever the amendment comes, I will also show you the date. How they are writing? The amendments with effect from 1st April 2021. This is how the amendments, FA20 amendments, you will find many of the amendments. They will write with effect from 1st of April 2021. Why they are writing this? What is the significance of this date? They understand this. That whatever is a law which is enforceable on the 1st of the April of the relevant AY, on the basis of that law, the tax liability will be determined. The tax liability will be determined. The tax liability, which is the function of two factors, which is that total income and the rate of tax. So definitely, the total income has to be computed as per the law, which is enforceable as per the law, which is enforceable on 1st of April 2021. The rate of tax has to be determined as per the law, which is enforceable on 1st of April 2021. So 1st of April 2021, students, is the game that you should always keep in mind. 1st of April 2021 is the game that you will always keep in mind, because that is the law on the law which is enforceable on that date, on the basis of which the total income will be computed. If supposingly, students, in the amendment, which has been there, in this context, in the amendment which has been there, supposingly they will write that with effect from, not for FA20 amendment, if they write, say, with effect from 1st of April, like that they write, say 62, or say 1st of April 76, amendment of FA20, but that amendment they will write like this, with effect from 1st April 62, or with effect from 1st April 1976, like that, if they are mentioning or referring to it, then this will become what? It will become a retrospective amendment. So obviously, this is how you should know that the amendment is retrospective. Now, what is the implication of retrospective amendment? That provision that we will do it, at that time I will let you know the implication. But at least, you should know what is prospective and what is retrospective. These two particular distinctions should be known by all of you. So, any amendment, FA20 amendment, when they say with effect from 1st April 21, which is a prospective amendment, and therefore what it becomes the law on 1st April 21, and that is what I require, that this should be the law as on 1st April 21, so as to compute the total income of the previous year 2021. The law which is there as on 1st April 21, as on that, on the basis of that law, I'll compute my total income. On the basis of that law, I'll also determine the rate of tax. And finally, I'll freeze my tax liability. This is the approach. So therefore, the significance of this relevant date, 1st of April 2021, 1st of April of the relevant AY, the earliest time when you can compute your total income, or the earliest time when you can determine your tax liability. Now, students, as I told you just now, that the total tax liability, is the function of two factors. And which are those two factors? One is the total income, another is the rate of tax. First of all, tell me the source of the rate of tax. What are the sources from where You get the rate of taxes. Quickly, students, get me the answer. What is the sources where you will get the rate of taxes? Quickly, answer me this. Sources from where you got your rate of taxes? Kamal, Bipin, Saneer, Krish, everyone are on board to say yes. I think all the students are on board to say that, sir, it is the Finance Act, the Annual Finance Act. Indeed it is. The Finance Act, which gives you the rate of taxes. In fact, all the Finance Act primary, the objective of the Finance Act, please understand one more point, friends. Let me in fact speak about it straight away. You are not doing the Income Tax Act 1961. You are not doing what? The Income Tax Act 1961. What you are learning is the Income Tax Act 1961 as amended till date. What are you learning? The Income Tax Act 1961 as amended till date. And what is the process of the amendment? The process of the amendment is through the Annual Finance Act. So primarily, the role of the Finance Act, one of the role, not the only role, but one of the role of the Finance Act is to make the legislative changes. To make what? To make the legislative changes in the scheme. In the scheme of both direct and the indirect taxes. To make the legislative changes in the scheme of both the direct and the indirect taxes. This is what this particular amendment is all about. To make the legislative changes in the scheme of both direct and indirect taxes. This is what the role of the Finance Act is all about. So, as you all said it correctly, yes, students, the source from where you will get the rate of income tax is the Annual Finance Act. Perfectly fine, students. But here lies another question. Or shall I say, here lies another catch. And what is that? Students, how about some very specific income when I say like LTCG, like short-term capital gains, like lottery winnings? Like say, very simple example, lottery winnings. What is the rate of tax for lottery winnings? So the rate of tax for the lottery winnings is how much? 30%, isn't it? Now this rate of 30%, you got it from where? From where you are getting this 30% rate of tax? So the 30% rate of tax, students, that you are getting is from the Finance Act? Is it from the Finance Act? Is it through the Finance Act? The 30% that you all have said to me right now, anyone can tell me about the section also in this context? It is not the Finance Act. Yes, now everyone is suggesting, no sir, it is in the Income Tax Act itself. This 30% is given to us. And somebody also would say the section also has 115BB for the lottery winnings. Yes, Bipin. So therefore, there is 115BB. So that is the rate at which the 30% is charged. Now this long-term capital gain of 112, again there is a special rate 20%. There is a short-term capital gain of 111A. Not all the short-term capital gains, but the short-term capital gains which qualifies for the concessional rate in 111A, which is at 15%. And there are many more sections where the special rate of tax, where the special rate of tax are being provided and it has been mentioned. So students, therefore, the source of tax. Now my question therefore is here in the source of tax, there are two source of tax which you should be very careful about it. Yes, Padmavati, you're right. Arjun, towards the end, I'll give these numbers and all. Just first focus on the lecture. So here, students, it is the Income Tax Act. The Income Tax Act 1961. And as you all said it correctly, students, the next one is the Finance Act. The Finance Act. And which Finance Act applicable for all of you? It is Finance Act 2020. Finance Act 2020. So here the Income Tax Act 1961 gives you the special rate of tax. On specific income. Special rate of tax on the specific income. Okay, that is what you will get it. And so far as the Finance Act is concerned, students, here, Finance Act is concerned, you will get, I'll say here, on balance total income. On the balance total income. Rate applicable as per the Finance Act, as per the Finance Act to each person on the balance total income, rate applicable as per the Finance Act to each person. This is what this particular rate would be all about. So the Income Tax Act, special rate of tax on the specific income. Now, this student's long-term capital gain, for example, or lottery winnings, for example. Now, whether it is earned by the individual or it is earned by a partnership firm or by a company, whether the rate will remain the same across the person? And the answer is yes. So, irrespective of who has earned the income, the special rate of tax provided in the Income Tax Act will remain constant. Repeat with me. Irrespective of who has earned the income, the special rate of tax as provided in the Income Tax Act 1961 shall remain constant. Whereas, as far as the Finance Act is concerned, in the Finance Act, the rate fluctuates depend upon for which person the tax rate is to be determined. The rate fluctuate depends upon for which person the tax rate has to be determined. This is the fundamental difference between the two, the Income Tax Act and the Finance Act. So in this context, students, if you see over here, the Income Tax Act 1961, when I have to write it over here, the special rate of tax on specific income. Herein. So, in this context, in this particular context, students, irrespective of the person who has earned the income, the special rate shall remain constant. Irrespective of the person who has earned the income, the special rate shall remain constant. Keep this point in mind, students. These are the very important observations that now we are having in this regard. Okay, so irrespective of the person who has earned the income, the special rate shall remain constant. Fine. And as I told you, when it comes to the Annual Finance Act for the balance total income, that rate will keep on fluctuating depending upon for which person the rate is sought to be determined. Now, students, herein, one more point which I just wanted to share with all of you. Please pay attention. Be very careful. When you talk about the Income Tax Act 1961 herein, which is for the special rate of tax in this context. Now, please understand, in IPCC, I think all of you would have done something in IPCC. You would have computed the total income. Say in your computation of total income, there is a LTCG income which is already there. In that total income, LTCG income is already there. Then what you all do? Then that LTCG income, you will first take out in computing your tax liability. The first step that you will do, the special income on which there is a special rate of tax under the Income Tax Act, you will apply the special rate first. And thereafter, on the balance total income, you apply what? The Finance Act. The Finance Act rate. Isn't it? The special provision always prevail over the general provision. What is the maxim? What is the theme? Repeat with me. The special provision always will prevail over the general provision. And based on that particular theme, students, we will say what? That the specific will prevail over the general. The specific will prevail over the general. So therefore, first is the special rate of tax will be applied on that special income, and thereafter, on the balance total income, you will apply the rate as per what? The Annual Finance Act. For you, the Finance Act is 2020. And thereafter, the surcharge. And for surcharge also, students, there are a bit of game to be played. What is that game? We'll see later. Right now, it's not the time. And finally comes the cess. And that is how you will calculate your tax liability. Please understand, the structuring is the key, students. That is very critical for all of you to really get hold with this. Now, if you have got hold with this particular point, now comes the real diversion. Students, what has happened in 2020? In fact, there is this category. Which category? For this category, what we are dealing with it, there is a scheme of what? Option of concessional tax rate. Concessional tax rate for every person. Option of concessional tax rate for every person, students. This is one of the very important development that has happened in the recent times. Up till the 2019 Finance Act, please pay attention to this one, students. Up till the Finance Act of 2019, we had this scheme applicable only for a company. We had what? The scheme which was applicable only for a company. With effect from FA 20, with effect from what? FA 20, this scheme is now being extended to all the other persons as well. The scheme is extended now to all the other persons as well. And what is the scheme here, in students? Just through a diagrammatical approach, I'll just try to make you understand the scheme herein. The scheme, students, up till now, so before and after theory, which I'll just put it across to all of you, just pay attention, students, here. The before scheme and the after, a diagrammatic representation will help you to appreciate what exactly has changed. Our objective, students, is just to develop the macro understanding. The structure should be very clear in your mind. And then once we come to the specific, we will give and we will root each and every in much detail. But without a structure, if you dig into the specific, you will definitely will fall and falter later on, and by then it will be too late. So my responsibility is also to ensure I make a formidable structure, foundation, the pillars, and on that basis we will develop our house. That is what primary which should always be borne in mind. The fundamentals are very clear, should be made very clear. Students, just pay attention to what is the structuring. Up till now, before the amendment which was there, as I was just told, I told you just now that the tax is a function of two factors. Which are those two factors? One is the rate of tax, another is the total income. One is the rate of tax and another is the total income. That is what the function of the tax is all about. So up till now, students, it was something like this. Before, the rate was, say, 30%. Say, I'm just giving an example, 30%. And this was your total income. This was your total income. This is all. The total income was calculated. And this total income, students, was being calculated after taking all the incentives, sorry, all the incentives which was available under the act, whatever was the incentives, deductions and all, whatever was available to you under the act, you used to claim those incentives, the deductions, and based on that you were being given the opportunity, you were being given the opportunity through the tax planning measure available to you under the act, you were given the opportunity to reduce your total income, and on that reduced total income you were applying the headline rate of 30%. I'm just giving an example. Now what they have done, primarily, suddenly you will find the change in the structure, and this change is as an option which they are giving it to you after the optional scheme. The optional scheme students, before amendment and now after the optional scheme, they will reduce the rate of tax. But don't worry, the government understand that on one hand they are reducing the rate, but what they have done, they are increasing the base. This is the total income that all of you will be computing without what? Total income without major deduction. Total income without major deduction. Now, which are those deductions? Don't worry, we will have our topics free, defined, practical problems also will be shared with all of you therein. And in that case, we will learn on this. But have the mind map, students, very important. What if I exercise this optional scheme, this is what it will happen. The total income, then I will be required to compute. The total income, then I will be required to compute without taking into account the major deduction. And then in that case, I will be then be given what? Given the nominal rate, 15%, say for example. I'm just giving an example, 15%. So lower rate, but on the higher tax base. Lower rate applied on what? On the higher tax base. What is the existing scheme? The earlier scheme or the existing scheme? The existing scheme or the earlier scheme was that average rate on the normal total income. Average rate on the normal total income, which is this particular part. But now they are giving you the option. Let us try to give you an option of reduced tax rate to be applied on a larger total income. How you get a larger total income? You will not be then taking into account, in computing the total income, you will not be taking into account the major deductions and the major incentives. That is how the total income will be computed, and on that, as I told you, apply on that the nominal rate of tax, and that is what the tax liability, that is how the tax liability will be freezed. Did you all got this one? This is what is the option that has been given. Now, therefore, every SSC has to take a call. And what is the call? That whether I should go for this optional scheme or I should be going as per the existing scheme. This particular choice, every SSC will be required to be made. Choice of either going as per the optional scheme, primarily, or the existing scheme. Now, at least, students, we can just right now speak within ourselves and without looking into that section. Right now, at least one thing we can all say clearly, that those SSC who don't otherwise avail, please pay attention. Those SSC who otherwise don't avail the major deduction, for them, whether this optional scheme, will you recommend them to go as per the optional scheme? And the answer is yes. Why? Because anyways, you were not even taking this deduction earlier. This major deductions you were not taking earlier. So for all those SSC, this will be recommended that look, since you otherwise don't take the deduction, you don't qualify for these major deduction, please opt for this concessional rate regime. But those SSC who are taking those major deduction, those SSC who are taking the major deduction, for them they need to work out two calculations. And what is the two calculation? Tax liability as per the existing scheme and the tax liability as per the optional scheme. And then after calculating both, he will finally have to decide which of the two is more beneficial for him. That is how they will take a call on that. So this is precisely, students, how the things will move forward, going forward. And therefore, we will deal with the practical problem also in this regard. Many problems we will do, solving the optional scheme, so that the benchmark or the threshold you should know, which is more beneficial for the SSE, whether he should opt for the optional scheme or he should go with the existing scheme also. Right now, students, I want to ask you a question. And please pay attention to the question which I'm asking to all of you. Please pay attention. The question which I'm asking is this. If supposing the SSE is opting for the optional scheme. If supposingly the SSE is opting for the optional scheme. Fine. And in the total income, he has got, say, lottery winnings or say long-term capital gains. Then on that special income, will he apply the special rate of tax, or will he apply on that special income the rate as per the optional scheme? Which is the two choice that I have given it to you? On the special income, will he apply the special rate of tax, and on the balance total income, he will apply what? Apply the rate as per the optional scheme, or on the entire total income, or on the entire total income, he will apply the rate as per the optional scheme. So that two choice which I have given it to you, you tell me, answer it through 1 and 2. Which is that option that he is going to take? Which is the correct alternatives of the two which I have given it to you? That for which SSC, by the way, students, again I am repeating, for which SSC? Those SSC who has taken the option of the concessional tax rate regime. For those SSC, if in their total income that they have calculated, which total income that they have calculated? This total income that they have calculated. In that total income, they have got special income. Which special income? I gave you the example, say LTCG or say lottery winnings. On this LTCG, will they apply the special rate of Income Tax Act, and on the balance total income, they will apply the reduced rate as per the optional scheme? This is alternative number one. Or alternative number two, on the entire total income, he will apply what? The concessional rate of the optional scheme. What is that he is going to do? The two alternatives I have given you. Alternative one is the correct answer, or alternative two is the correct answer. Saneer has given the answer. Krish, Kamal. Students, one thing also I will discuss with all of you, but before that, I'll just quickly wrap it up, this particular part. Harish also has given the answer. And the alternative one is the correct alternative. Students, be careful. Which alternative? Alternative number one is the correct alternative. That even in the case of where the SSC is opting for the optional scheme, the new optional scheme which is available to him, and in that total income, which is a larger tax base, in that total income, if he has got any special income in that total income, then what, students? Then in that particular case, on that special income, the special rate of tax which is there in the Income Tax Act will continue to apply. And on the balance total income, the reduced rate as per the optional scheme will apply. So don't make an error of applying the rate as per the optional scheme on the entire total income. No, even that bifurcation will still exist. Which bifurcation? On this total income that we have calculated, we need to still bifurcate. Bifurcate what? That whatever is the special income, primarily on the special income, primarily, and the balance total income, this bifurcation, students, will still be there. Again, I'm repeating, special income, special rate of tax as per the Income Tax Act. Example, 111A, 112, 115BB, and on the balance total income, the reduced rate as per the optional scheme, So please understand and never make an error in the first class itself. Naveen, we need to have the data and only then we will conclude primarily. So definitely I will give all the permutation combination questions in this alternative tax scheme. We need to have data, but the approach is the key. How do you do the approach? Okay, the approach is the key primarily, which you should always keep in mind. Now in that context, I think all of you would have copied down this one here. As I have told you here, total income in this category, same approach here in the special income. The special rate as per the IT Act, and on the balance total income that you apply the rate, the general rate as per the Finance Act. The general rate as per the Finance Act. Okay. So students, make no mistake, primarily on the special income, whether he is exercising the option or he does not exercise the option, on the special income, always you will apply the special rate of tax. On the special income, you will always apply the special rate of tax and the balance total income. That's where the game changes. And what is the change in the game? The change in the game is, if I'm not opting for the reduce or the optional scheme, then the Finance Act rate. But if I'm opting for the optional scheme, then in that case, the reduced rate would be applicable. But please be careful. Even the computation of total income will be different here. Even what? The computation of total income has to be distinct here. How do you calculate total income? By foregoing major deduction, students. By letting go major deductions, you will compute your total income. So total income would be a much enlarged figure. And on that total income, you'll apply what? The applicable tax rate. On that total income, you'll apply the reduced tax rate. Okay, the balanced total income, you'll apply the reduced tax rate. This is exactly how the things gets concluded. So be careful, students. The option which is there is not on the special income. The on the special income, whatever is there, which is as per the Income Tax Act, on that special income, you will continue to apply the tax rate. You will continue to apply the tax rate as per the Income Tax Act. That will never change. And as I told you, it is only on the balance total income. It is only on what? The balance total income. That the option, whether you have to exercise or not, you have to exercise, that call everyone has to take. Everyone now will be taking the call on the balance total income, whether I should go with the existing rate of the Finance Act or I should be going as per what? Going as per the concessional scheme. I told you, students, we are going to discuss this particular part heavily through a lot of practical problems. I have been going to give it to you because you need to have a very good understanding of this part. This is a very big change or a big transformation. In fact, this is going to, it is actually laying down the roadmap going forward. That going forward, the rate would be low and the base would be higher. Going forward, again, repeat with me, rate would be low and the base would be higher. What is the base? It is a total income. That is the going forward scheme of the country. So this is one thing that you should always keep in mind in this context. So students, as we are decoding right now, decoding what? How to compute the tax liability This computation of tax liability will be, repeat with me, this computation of tax liability will be as per the law, which is enforceable on the relevant date. And what is the relevant date? The relevant date happens to be the 1st April of the relevant AY. The relevant date happens to be the 1st April of the relevant AY. On the basis of that particular law, we will have to determine the tax liability. For the purpose of determination of tax liability, as per the law applicable on the relevant date, we need to determine or we need to ascertain what is the applicable rate of tax and what is the total income. And the rate of tax, applicable rate of tax, we get it from two sources. And the two sources are the Income Tax Act providing you the special rate of tax which you need to apply on the special income, which is forming a part of your total income. So on that special on that particular special income, apply special rate of tax. And on the balanced total income, students, on the balanced total income, you have the option. What is the option? Either you pitch for the existing rate as per the Finance Act or the reduced rate as per the new scheme of taxation. But if you go for that option, which option? The option of the reduced rate, you have to forego major deductions. You have to forego major incentives. This is one of the learning that we are going to have it. And this, we am going to constantly hammer you lecture after lecture, so that this is what is the scheme that you should know. Primarily, that going forward, this is the scheme that is available to the SSC, every SSC now. So what is that, students? This is what it is. Now we are going to, in the next class, students, I am going to, first four lectures, I will have the luxury of the limited, we'll have the discussion so that you absorb it. And every students, what I am going to do is that every session, next session also, I am going to first quickly do a recap of the previous class. Okay, I'm going to do a quick recap of the previous class. But before that, it is important that you also, when you in fact go to the next class, because you all have now done a day gap. After Tuesday, you will meet me now on Thursday. At least you can take out some time of whatever we have done. You have also equal responsibility, students, to revise it once. So that one time learning in the class, quick revision or recapping towards the end of the lecture, one time revision at your end, and in the next class, before the start of the next class, I'll do one quick revision of whatever you have done in the previous session. This will make your mind settle down with a particular concept. But students, one thing I can tell you, in all the series of revision, nothing substitute your revision, the self-study that you are going to do in between. Nothing can substitute your revision. So please understand, this is actually where everything will fall apart. If that small revision which was required from your end, if you have given that a miss, I'm not only talking about DT, it is applicable for any subject. If you give it a miss completely, I think all the effort, hard work, primarily will go for a toss. You will not be sure as to what will be the possible outcome. Anyways, people are never sure of the outcomes. But don't do this, then you are playing or living dangerously. It will hardly take, students, very few particular, like 15 minutes, half an hour max tops. Beyond that, you'll not be required to do the self-study. That assurance I can give it to you. But please do invest, have the habit of doing those quick revisions, because that is also equally, it's a partnership that we are into it. 50%, it's take two to tango, isn't it? That is what we say. So unless from your side there is an equal effort and participation which is there for the session, you cannot have the best of the outcome. So therefore, the journey is a journey of our partnership. And as I told you, the partnership requires, in every partnership, it requires both the parties to be willing to participate effectively. So students, we will stop over here now. Now, one particular point which I tell you, students, you have got what? Integrated MCQs. I think all of you have heard of this. So in fact, in our particular booklet, in the five modules and all, you'll find various integrated MCQs that I'm going to put forth. I'm not saying that you'll get the same MCQ primarily. Obviously, you'll not get the same. But at least you'll get to know the approach, how to really crack. Because integrated MCQ requires a lot of interlinking of various things. So what I'm going to do is that in my second book, I'm going to use integrated MCQ for book one content and book two content. So that will be something we are going to put it in our second booklet. So that effectively, lot of content, we can make case studies. And through that, we will give the integrated MCQ. So this is a part and parcel of your upcoming, the MCQs pattern in which they are going to ask. Case study. It's just the way in IIM, the entrance examination of the CAT, in all these IIMs and all, they also give the reading comprehension, integrated MCQs. Like case study is there. And on, based on that case study, they will pitch for the MCQs. And that is what even the ICA has taken a leaf from the common admission test, which are conducted in various IIMs. So we have all going forward. This is what it is. As such, nothing is there. It requires a thorough understanding of the syllables. Okay. I will be leaving no stone unturned, students. It will be very robust, very effective preparation that we are all going to get into it. Only thing, as I told you, it requires just your participation of that 15 to half an hour maximum to quick revision and be ready for the next session. One day gap purposely has been given so as to span out the schedule very well. So again, I'm repeating, students, 4 days in a week, we'll have our lectures and you will be primarily all the G Drive students who will be opting for G Drive, for them after 10th of July, the G Drive batches will be made available for a limited period. Students, we will be having the lectures at a very concessional price. So please ensure that to all the friends who are there, do let them know also about this particular lecture. In fact, this link for the first four lectures which are there of the regular batch, this four lectures of the regular batch will always be available in the YouTube, in our YouTube channel. And through that, you can always push this link so that the students, after four lecture, it will be in the secured platform. After four lecture, it will be in the secured platform, but with the same features. Okay, so that is how it would be, so that all the other students also can have a look to the lectures as well. Shreyans, just let that particular student know. Shreyans. In this WhatsApp particular message, which is there, 97794. Okay, now the queries which has been there, students, I'll give two number only for WhatsApp purpose. We will be anyway making the groups and all. First one is my number, but please only do WhatsApp in this regard and allow me time to reply instantly. Our office, you can always WhatsApp at this number, 97794300034. Okay, students, now I'll see you when on Wednesday. Sorry, on Thursday. So on Thursday, WhatsApp your details, Shreyans, on this number as well. You will WhatsApp your details and they will try to do something needful. Don't worry. So now, students, herein, I'll see you on Thursday. We'll also start with what? With the 6:15 for our batch. Link again would be in our same particular lecture. Would be given in our view, because it's through YouTube only. But very popularly, students are telling me to push the timings to 6:30. Okay, so that students can participate in this particular entire lecture effectively, knowing the situation which would be there. So 6:30 timing, students, I'll do it after the fourth class, because till the time it goes in the YouTube, four lectures, I'll do it at 6:15. Thereafter, I'll start at 6:30. If that is the popular request from many of the students for the live batch, then I'll switch it to 6:30. Okay, and that is what I'm again telling you, the backup would be given both for G Drive as well as for the live batch. If you happen to miss out on the session, the backup facility is always available to all of you. Fine, so don't worry as far as the backup facility is concerned. Okay, but you have to intimate that you have missed on this particular lecture so that they can accordingly provide you the backup for the same. Fine. See you then, students, in the next lecture, which would be on Thursday. Thank you.